Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining us tonight. Tonight, we'll be celebrating women in the spirit of the season, and absolutely because they deserve it today, yesterday, tomorrow, literally every day. And we'll be looking at a very apt topic, inspiring women inclusion in leadership. And today, to discuss this particularly engaging topic with us, is someone who, when you say, would the caps fit, we have the privilege and pleasure of having with us a fellow of the Institute of the Chartered Institute of Nigeria. And our facilitator for tonight is someone I've had the privilege of knowing and interacting with very close quarters, is someone who walks the talk. Ajayi Adeyemi Akinfemi is an accomplished and passionate human resource professional with a proven record of performance and goal achievement spanning various industries, including professional services and consulting, financial services, logistics, digital solutions, manufacturing, fast-moving consumer goods, and health services. With professional career spanning about two decades, is achievement-oriented, result-focused, multi-skilled and performance-driven. He loves to focus on strategy, leadership, and people development. Ladies and gentlemen, he has records of accomplishments for development, talent management, employee engagement, learning and development, change management, reward and benefit administration, and excellent HR service delivery that creates great people express while contributing to the bottom line and also sustainability. Adeyemi is an active member of several professional associations and holds various certificates from reputable HR certification bodies, both local and foreign. Some of them include Senior Professional Human Resource International, SPHRI, from the Human Resource Certification Institute of the United States of America. Is a full member of the Nigerian Institute of Training and Development, Institute of People Management Professionals, South Africa, and a fellow of the prestigious Chartered Institute of Personnel Management of Nigeria. Yemi sits on the Governing Council of the CIPM as an elected council member. Before now, he had served as the chairman, CIPM Lagos State Branch, the flagship branch, and served as chairman of the planning committee of the CIPM International Conferences and Exhibition of the CIPM. At the moment, Adeyemi is the head human resources of Synlab Nigeria, Europe number one medical diagnostics provider, and is the HR lead for Synlab Emerging Markets, covering 13 countries in Europe, Africa, and Middle East. Adeyemi Ajayi is passionate about people development and good leadership. Ladies and gentlemen, for the first time on this prestigious platform, HR Mentorship Learning Series, it's my privilege and pleasure to present to you Adeyemi Ajayi. You are welcome, sir.
Thank you very much, my sick and fellow elected council member, Oluyemi Adeosun, MCIPM. Distinguished colleagues, ladies and gentlemen, I'm glad and so happy to be in your midst this evening. Again, let me first start by saying Happy International Women's Day. Yesterday was the day dedicated for the celebration of women across the globe. Again, tomorrow, for some of us, tomorrow is also Mothering Sunday. So we cannot stop celebrating women. This evening, we will be looking at how can we inspire women inclusion in leadership position? What are the challenges and what are the some of the solutions or panacea, as the case may be, that we can look at? So join me as I take on this journey. It's going to be an interactive session, and I'm hoping that more people will join us and you participate fully, both in the chat room and also If you do have questions later on, we'll take the Q&A. The outline, we will start with some introduction. We'll look at the challenges of women inclusion in leadership roles. We'll look at some characteristics of some of the women who have had the opportunity of leading in various aspects of life. And then we will look at how women can improve their visibility, both at home, in the career life, in the social space, religious environment, and every aspect of life. Then we will now focus on how can we inspire the inclusion of women, across board. If we have enough time, we can look at some of the prominent Nigerian women. I'm a strong believer in Nigeria. I believe in Nigeria. I'm proudly Nigeria. So we'll be looking at some of the examples of women in Nigeria who probably have been able to break that ceiling and contribute to leadership. So join me on this journey as we'll start with let's enjoy grace.
Made. I wonder if God is a woman.
If you can't divide, you can sing along. You can unmute and
the
sing along.
The gift of life astounds me to this day.
This
I give it up for the woman. She's the constant wind that fills my sail. Oh, that woman. A smile and a star, she'll protect you like a child. That's a woman. She'll put a smile upon her face and take you to the higher place. So don't you underestimate strength of a woman.
I know some of us are probably enjoying that music. Okay, so yes, I've taken us down memory lane. Yeah, it's down memory lane. Shaggy talking to us about the strengths of a woman, the strength of a woman. They are powerful. Now, Michelle Obama, the former First Lady of the United States of America, once said that no country can ever truly flourish if it stifles the potential of its women and deprive itself of the contribution of half of its citizens. This speaks a lot about the power of women and I mean how important women are, within our society. We cannot in any way put aside or overlook the contribution of women. And any attempt to try to stifle their ability to be able to truly flourish, it is an attempt to deprive ourselves of what they bring to the table in terms of the God-endowed attributes that women have, even amongst us. Now, I would like us to describe the character, what we feel today. If I ask us a question here, how are you doing today? How are you doing today? So let's get into the chat room. I want you to describe the way you feel today using an animal that represents, that has the characteristics that represent the way you feel. When you wake up this morning, how did you feel? And up to now, physically, how did you feel? Let's get into the chat room. How did you feel when you wake up this morning physically. Let's see our responses in the chat room. Which animal represents the way you feel when you wake up this morning? Did you feel like a bird? Did you feel like a lion? Did you feel like a dog? Which animal represents how you felt when you wake up this morning? Yes, Samuel Oluwafemi says you felt like a bull. Obiageli says she feels felt like a lion. Julian, accomplished is not an animal. Let's use an animal that describes, that has that characteristic that describes the way you feel, you know, today. Okay, Gazelle, Alaji Gobir, you're welcome, sir. Oh, parrot. Olori Adiaja, I feel like talking. Panda, leopard, Favor says leopard. Okay. Eagle, Japari Yusuf says he felt like an eagle. Oh, butterfly, he wants to fly. Adiola Falodun wanted to fly this morning. Great, fantastic. All these animals, eagle, butterfly. Thank you very much. All of these animals, they have very unique characteristics in their own right. Oh, Omoba says, Labrador dog, calm and quiet and relaxed. Interesting. That's good. That's Omoba. Princess, thank you very much. Now, that is physically. Let us now examine, how did you feel spiritually? How would you describe your feeling? Which animal describes your feeling spiritually today? Which animal describes your feeling spiritually today? Which animal describes your feeling spiritually today? You know, we are spirit beings. The ego. The spiritual ego. Wow. Ego, Julian. Ego. Wow. Ego. Lion. Spirits wise, the lion, calm spirits, but very strong physical attributes. Interesting. Any other person? Sheep. Susie says sheep. Uneka says lioness, unbeatable. Alaji Gobril says eagle. Interesting. Dove, as calm as a dove, the spiritual bird, as calm as a dove. Damilola says she feels like a dove. All right, thank you very much for your response. It's good to know that we all are feeling very great this morning, from dove to eagle to lion to parrot to lioness, great one. All right, let's delve straight quickly into our conversation. Now, when we look at women across the board, women are making giant strides in leadership, and they are making their presence felt in the area of entrepreneurship, administration, talk of health, talk of engineering, talk about the regional aspect, national, global wise. We are seeing a lot of women that are showing how great and how good they can be when given the opportunity to step into leadership roles. A lot of women have resolved to break that traditional glass ceiling, you know, that has barred them over the years from entering to leadership positions. Even when they possess those skills, we find out that a lot of times it's been a lot difficult for women to be able to break that glass ceiling. However, several women, they have resolved and they have indeed been able to break that glass ceiling, and they are making great impact. Women keeps evolving and they are reaching quite a lot of milestones across various, you know, spectrum of human activities, you know, in these modern times. And the world has witnessed, and we keep witnessing, the advent of many successful leaders, you know, amongst us, especially women. Start from the Vice President of the United States of America, Kamala Harris, from the House of Assembly to becoming the Vice President of the country. People like Oprah Winfrey, you know, the television TV icon. Talk of Angela Merkel, the former Chancellor of Germany. Talk of Ellen Johnson Sirleaf, the former President of Liberia. And we can name a whole lot more. Let me see in the chat room. How many of such great international women do you know? Let's see your response in the chat room. How many of such great international women that you have seen that have been able to reach new milestones across various spectrums of human activity? Let's see responses in the chat room. Do you know of any woman globally, from India to Jamaica to America to Nigeria to Australia, how many women do you know that have been able to, you know, brave it all, you know, to achieve new things? I'm not seeing your response in the chat room. Let's be more engaging in, you know, this conversation this evening. Yes, Funke Felix Adejumo, the popular pastor, Mrs. FFA. Yes, any other person globally, women who are doing great things. Yes, Indra Noye, the CEO of PepsiCo in the United States of America. Yes, Indra Noye. Yes, that's correct, Yusuf Jampari. Any other person do you want to give us? Nkosi Ekojaiweala, the former Minister of Finance. Mo Abudu, the TV entrepreneur. Shola David Boha. Yes, Shola David Boha, Stanbic IBTC Holding, the Standard Bank Group. Yes, former Mrs. Late Mrs. Dora Kunyele, the former NAVDAC DG. Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much. And many more. Yes, Adiza Bala Usman, the first male CEO of Nigerian Port Authority. Yes, Al Jazeera Mufemi Oke of Al Jazeera. She moved to CNN recently. Oh, yes. Thank you very much. So women are very powerful. They are powerful agents. Yes, Funke Alakija. Yes, please. Women are powerful change agents. And the far-reaching benefits of diversity and gender parity in leadership and decision-making, they are increasingly being recognized, you know, all over the world. And this is the strength of women. Yet, despite all of these great women that we have mentioned, despite the great giant strides that women are taking all across the world, it is unfortunate that we have continued to underrepresent them in decision-making. Politics, business, governance in our communities, we have continued to underrepresent them. And the reason for this are some of the things that we're going to be looking at this evening. That despite all of this, why has it continued to be challenging for us to include women in leadership roles? Now, we've had opportunity of some women being able to move into leadership positions. So let us look at some of the women that we have talked about. What are some of the characteristics, the attributes that they have demonstrated, you know, while taking on leadership roles? Women have these strong transformational leadership skills. Give a woman, donate a sperm to a woman, and she'll make a child, a baby, a human being out of it. They have this wonderful transformational leadership skills. Give a woman one naira and she will make a million out of it. They transform anything that you hand over to them. And this is very, very, very apt when we talk about women who have had opportunities of taking on leadership role. Somebody mentioned Dora, late Dora Akuyili. Before Dora Akuyili, NAVDAC has always existed. People have always led NAVDAC. But that wonderful woman took charge of that particular government institution and made it look as if it was just created. She made it look as if NAVDAC was just coming into existence. And these are the great things that women do. They transform things that is handed over to their hands. They have strong transformational leadership skill. Another major characteristic that you found with women who have been successful in leadership role is that they are task focused. You find out that a woman will carry a child in her hands. The child is crying, and the woman will reach out to breastfeed the child. With another hand, the woman is busy cooking a wonderful stew on fire, and at the same time, she's trying to attend to a phone call. But guess what? Each of those tasks that is happening simultaneously, a woman has the capacity to be able to focus on each of them and be able to deliver and perform each of them at the same time with clear focus. This is something that a lot of men like myself are not able to actually do, juggling several balls at the same time, yet remaining focused on each of those balls and not dropping anyone. But women in leadership, they have been able to demonstrate these very great, rare characteristics. Women promote cooperation and collaboration. Men, a lot of times, we like to work in silo because we like to compete. Men like competition. We always want to outdo ourselves, want to outsmart one another. We want to have that bragging right. But for women, they tend more towards cooperation and collaboration, coming together to tap into one another's strengths to be able to achieve, you know, success. You find more of such attributes with a lot of women who have been successful in leadership roles. Again, communication style. Women are very persuasive in the way they communicate. Men are usually authoritative, commanding, taking control, want to exert. Men are usually assertive. But women, they have this very persuasive style of speaking. They are able to get you to do what you are vowed not to do. Just imagine yourself as a husband. You tell your wife, I'm only going to give you X amount of money as, you know, housekeep allowance for the month. And that is all I have. Now, you'll be shocked that you are in the car with your wife. And the next thing, she sees people on the street. Probably they are selling pepper, tomatoes, looking very fresh. The next thing, your wife just begins with the story of, babe, when was the last time I cooked you that your lovely jollof rice? And, you know, that lovely red stew. How can't you see that tomato is looking very fresh? And I don't have my purse ale. Babe, can I have 1,000 naira there? At least I can buy some and let me cook you that nice soup. Before you know it, you are reaching out to your pockets to bring that 1,000 naira out. Despite the fact that you say you don't have any other budget again for that. That is how persuasive women can be in terms of communication. The same way, even in the office, if you are a boss and you have, you know, a female junior colleague reporting to you, yes, tell me you are laughing. That is, you find that happening every time. You find that a woman, she doesn't want to come to work tomorrow, and you have said that nobody is taking any leave. I'm not approving leave for anybody in this month again until you are able to deliver your, you know, on your target and all of that. And the next thing, a female colleague will walk into your office. In fact, from the way her facial expression alone, you will not know how your heart will just melt. And by the time she's telling you, sir, it's your son that is not feeling too okay. This morning, he was too lean. And wasn't, I mean, he had high temperature. And I just managed because of what you asked us to do to come to work. Sir, I was wondering if you could. By the time she, you know, comes with all those facial expression and all of that, you will know why. You just say, you know what do you want? Okay, you want to, okay, no worry, just go. Just make sure that you do, but you can go, you can go. That is how persuasive. Yes, you do that a lot, women. Exactly. Thank you, Diabiola. You know, and that is their communication style. It's very, very persuasive. Self-branding. When you see an average woman, she's able to look at you from, you know, top to toe, and she can tell you the perfume that you are wearing, even without getting close to you. When you look at an average woman, you will see their shoe is matching with their bags. Even the wristwatch they are putting on, the headgear, even their spectacles, the eyeglasses, you'll be shocked. They are very good at branding themselves. When you see an average woman, you look at them, they will tell you she's carrying a Korg bag, you know, a Gabbani bag. All of those brand names and all of that, women, they know it all. They are very good at self-branding. When you see a man that you can say, this man dressed very well, check out, there is the brand manager, the wife, or some girlfriend somewhere that is taking care of that brand that you are seeing. Women are very good with self-branding. Again, they are able to adapt to their environment, and they are quite very flexible. You'll find it easily, you know, with married women. It's very easy for a woman to leave her father's house and her parents' house and move in with a man and quickly, immediately adjust and adapt to a new environment. They are quite very flexible. The same thing, even in the workplace. When a woman transits from one role to another, you see how quickly they're able to adapt rather than grumbling, like a lot of men ordinarily would do. Oh, I'm an expert. Yeah, this is what I love to do. Why are you moving me? But oftentimes you find out that women, they are able to easily adjust. You can easily mold them. They are quite flexible, much more than a lot of men. I know some of the men on this call, you are probably jealous by now, and you want to put up an argument. Don't worry. You will find out, if you find a woman around you, you will see that they demonstrate a lot of these attributes, you know, quicker, better, a lot more than a lot of men. When you see women in leadership, the successful ones amongst them, they are very resilient and they are determined. They are resilient, they are determined. They go all out. They believe that, yes, the boys are the one playing on this field, but they make up their mind and they focus on breaking the barrier and getting into that fold and making the difference. This attribute is very, very unique. Again, women, they have empathy and they have very strong emotional intelligence. Just check out in the house, when you get to the house as a man and you bone up and you are looking so tired and all that, meanwhile, your children, they are about coming to you to ask for something for school and all of that. Usually, you'll see your wife telling them to calm down. She'll ask you, babe, why don't you get into the bathroom, have your bath while I serve the table and get the table ready for you. She allows you to calm down, eat, and then stylishly, she brings in that request. And before you know it, you've given in to all of that. Emotional intelligence. Women, they demonstrate a lot of this, even in the home front, even in the office. Now, we will take a quick survey right now. You have on my screen, and I'm going to drop in the chat room. I'm going to quickly drop for us in the chat room a link for us to take this survey. If you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, if you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, tell us in the chat room. Sorry, one moment. Tell us in the chat room, if you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, will you prefer a male or a female boss? 1 minute. I will drop the link in the chat room. So that we can take this. Yes, please just click the link in the chat room. If you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, will you be going for a male or a female boss? If you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, will you be going for a male boss or a female boss? Okay. Let's see how we are voting. Okay. Male, female. Let's see how we are voting. Male boss. Two more minutes. Let's see. We have 40 people on this call. Only 15 have voted. We have 40 people on this call. Only 15 have voted. You can also scan the QR code. You can also scan the QR code to vote. If you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, would you prefer a male boss or a female boss? We have 17 votes yet. We have 17 votes yet out of 39 that we have on this call. 18 votes now. We have 19 votes. Let's see. If you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, will you choose a male or a female boss? Okay, 30 seconds more.
Some people are trying to drop in their vote as a message.
I am seeing those in the chat room. Please let us use the Mentimeter. Let's click on the link and use the Mentimeter. I've dropped that link again. If you missed the link, let's use the link. Let's use the indicator. Yes, I know you were what we both, but we are saying that if you have the opportunity of choosing your boss, will it be a male or a female? just click on the Mentimeter link that is in the chat room. We only have just 19 persons out of 40 who have used the Mentimeter. Okay. I'm giving 30 more seconds so that those that have dropped theirs in the chat box, we can go and use the Mentimeter quickly. 15 seconds more, and 10 seconds more, and 5 seconds more. And there you go. Yes, there you have it. So 14 persons says they would prefer to have a male boss. Why 9 persons says they would prefer to have a female boss? Now you can see why we have more male, you know, dominating our business space. Okay, thank you very much, everyone. Now we can see some of the reasons why we have the men dominating this our space. Okay, let's quickly continue with our presentation. Now we'll be looking quickly at challenges to women inclusion in leadership roles. What are the challenges to women inclusion in leadership roles? I would like us again to go into the chat room and let us have this conversation. What are the challenges that you think that women are facing that is limiting them from being able to have a seat at the table? Let's drop our answers in the chat room. What are those challenges that we think that women are facing in being able to sit in the leadership position? What challenges do we think that women are dealing with, are having to face in being able to assume leadership roles? What are the challenges of women inclusion? Gender bias, Obiageli, yes. Glass ceiling, yes. Gender bias, again, Kike Lomo. Any more? Stereotypes, yes. Stereotypes. Childbearing religious beliefs, yes. Oluchi, childbearing religious beliefs. Socio-cultural factors. Oh, patriarchy, culture and upbringing. Susie Ajilaye, culture and upbringing. Yes, Kochi is saying they feel that women should be within a certain level and cannot move beyond that. Women should be within a certain level and cannot move beyond that. Maternal body issues. Yes, maternal body issues. Self-limitation. Yes, self-limitation. Women are limiting themselves. Self-limitation. Stereotypes again, Oloriadia Jai, stereotypes again. Yeah, thank you very much. Yes, you have mentioned quite a number of some of those challenges. Just a minute, some technical issues to take care of here. My slide, okay. Good. Now, let's look at some of these things that you have mentioned. Gender stereotype. Now, what you find out is that societal stereotypes, they often portray leadership role as being masculine due to that very deep ingrained societal norms. When we say a leader, even amongst women, I'm sure on this call now, if I ask a lot of women on this call, like we've seen in our last, you know, survey poll that we took, will you prefer to have a male boss or a female boss? A lot of us, majority of us, will prefer to have female bosses. The same thing, you know, amongst women. I was at an organization yesterday to speak to them, you know, on this occasion of International Women's Day. And I had, you know, close to about 40 women in the room that I was engaging. And I asked them to just scribble on a sheet of paper if they would prefer to have a male boss or a female boss. Guess what? Out of 40 ladies in the room, 36 of them would prefer to have male bosses rather than female bosses. So even amongst women, they have agreed on their own that the leadership position is masculine in nature. And this is born out of our societal, you know, ingrained norms. Another major factor challenge that we see is the glass ceiling, as Yemi Adeosun mentioned, put in the chat room. Meanwhile, this glass ceiling, this barrier that we seem to be talking about is actually invisible. There is this invisible systemic barrier that has been placed in the career path of women. And this makes it very hard for a lot of women to aspire to get into leadership positions. However, it is pertinent to also mention that a lot of women are beginning to understand the need to break this barrier, because in the recent sense of it, those barriers are actually invisible. They are often imagined than real. Another major challenge is salary disparity. Salary disparity. There is what we call the gender-based pay gap in many industries and many sectors. And this reflects in some of our inequalities, which often discourage a lot of women from participating in leadership. How do you say that these are the perks for a particular position, for a particular grade? But the moment you find out that a woman is going to be the one to occupy that grade, you then begin to reveal the pay and the benefit of that office. A lot of sectors, you have this as a challenge that is limiting women from participating in leadership position. Critical is this number four, lack of mentorship, lack of career mentors. A lot of women, they don't have the opportunity of having other females mentor them. Because even amongst females themselves, there seems to be this strained relationship amongst them, which I will call in quotes, some kind of envy, unhealthy rivalry amongst women, such that even a woman that is already in a leadership role doesn't find it comfortable or convenient to mentor the younger ones, to help them build that capacity, to build that competence. Okay? Now, and this is discouraging a lot of women from pursuing leadership roles because they lack female advocates. They lack mentors that can make way for them at the top. And this is limiting a whole lot of women from aspiring to leadership positions. And this is a very critical factor. Another factor is discrimination and harassment. Women often face very hostile work environments because a lot of our men are abusive. Even co-workers, those in position of authority, they are very, very hostile at times. And this discourages women from pursuing leadership roles. You know, you hear things like, "Are you not a woman? I have a woman like you at home as a wife. Who are you? What do you think? Who do you think you are?" And we create very hostile, you know, work environments for women. We don't really appreciate some unique attributes that they have and some limitations that nature has also put on their way. We tend to discriminate against them. A lot of us, when we want to hire, there is a lot of focus around, positions that you want male to occupy. And when you ask why, no, if you take a woman now, the next thing she'll tell you she's pregnant. She'll be away for 9 months and work cannot stop. And this subtle discrimination, they are very evident in our workplaces. Then you find a lot of times men in the office staring, giving very deep, funny, interesting look at women around them, making them uncomfortable. And all of this discrimination, there are some of the challenges, you know, for women aspiring into leadership role. Now, we have a male-dominated network. Oftentimes, you look around you, all you see in the work environment, in leadership role, is female. A lot of times, it's looking as if we are doing women favors by inviting them to sit at the table. When a woman finds herself trying to break into, you know, the big boys club, in quotes now, it could pose a whole lot of challenge to our ambition. Imagine, a lot of times, you will fix meeting at odd hours when you know that a woman is expected to also go and perform other functions, domestic functions. Especially in politics, you see a lot of politicians, they fix their meetings in the middle of dead of the night when they know that it's practically almost impossible for a lot of women to be able to participate because they need to juggle between their home and also their career. even in the workplace, long meeting hours. For a lot of us, it is after work hours that we want to have management meetings because we believe that there will be a lot of distraction during the work hours. And this often affects a lot of women from being able to aspire to leadership roles. And this thing happens in a lot of organizations, whether it's multinational environment or owner-managed businesses, MSMEs, you still find a lot of these things happening. They will say that, oh, we will only be able to concentrate on having meeting either very early. Some of us will fix, you know, you have these our management meetings, we'll say 7 a.m. in the morning. You know, rather than, you know, fixing a meeting, what's wrong with 10 o'clock to 12 o'clock business hours? These are some of the things. You know, when it's a male-dominated, you know, environment, we tend to, you know, do things just only with men of our types, you know, in mind, without thinking of the women amongst us. Then there is this issue of tokenism. You know, for a lot of people, gender diversity and inclusion is only seen as just ticking the box. Oh, because we have 5 male. You know what? Let's at least, for the sake of the world also seeing us that we are not biased towards women, let us have at least one woman on the management team. Not because we think that the woman is competent and capable of holding that role, but just because we just want to tick the box. And a lot of times, we don't have very honest policy trust towards gender diversity and inclusion. And I find this very, very interesting in a lot of organizations. Tokenism is very, very real. Very, very real. You hear things like, oh, being made president of an international society and being congratulated on being a woman, rather than, you know, being the fact that this person has achieved some scientific achievements. You see clients talking about your pretty face being the asset. You know, for some organizations, you find that, oh, when they are looking for marketers, business development managers, sales executives, oh, they want to specifically go and look for those beautiful ladies who have certain figures, shape, and all of that. Tokenism. These are issues that are preventing women from aspiring to leadership roles. Again, lack of flexibility and support. You know, a lot of times, how many of us on this call have, you know, places where women can breastfeed in the office? Nurseries, what do you call it now? Where you take care of children. Crèche. How many of us have crèche in our office? Let's see in the chat room. How many of us have crèches in our offices? Let's see our response in the chat room. Okay, Adiola says we do. If you have crèche in your office, let's see, not applicable. Interesting, crèche says not available. Or if you have a nursery where women can just go, we know get, we do at LBS. Oh, very good, great. We do, edits. Ayamu says, yes, we do. Great, great. Julian says, no way. You see, these are things that we need to begin to think of. Making it flexible. Okay, it's in the books, Loretta. Interesting. It's in the books. We always think about it in our policy document, our strategy. But execution becomes an issue. You see, there is a lot, even in our policies, in our office, even in policy development, when we look at these things, parental leave, child care leave, all of these things can pose a stumbling block to women being able to aspire to leadership role. You know, how many of us are still working with a 12 weeks maternity leave, for example? Let's tell us in the chat room, how long is your maternity leave for women? How long is your maternity leave in your organization? How many months, how many weeks do you give as maternity leave? 12 weeks, minimum statutory requirement, 3 months, minimum statutory requirement. Yes, Adiola Falodu, great, 4 months, 16 weeks. That's great, fantastic. Julian, 3 months. You see, these are the issues. A lot of us just want to do the barest minimum as provided by the labor law. Meanwhile, the labor law only says minimum. Again, a lot of us, we don't just even the so-called 12 weeks that we have put there, some of us even have policies that says that they must take 6 weeks, before their delivery, before their EDD, and then 6 weeks after their EDD. And we do know that sometimes women give birth and it could be challenging. The child could need some extra care after delivery. And our policies are not flexible enough to support them. And these are things that are limiting women. Some of us even have policies that says that a woman cannot, when a woman comes back from maternity leave, she cannot take another maternity leave until after another 24 months or 48 months, as the case may be. Some of us even have such policies that says that they can't get pregnant until another, you want to determine to manage their family for them. And they can't get pregnant again until after 2 years before they can have opportunity of maternity leave. These are some of the policies that do not support our women. And it is quite interesting that we are not looking at making the workplace more flexible and more supporting, okay, for women. Now, we also have the issue of workplace culture. Again, emphasis is on aggressive leadership. Some of our leaders are very, very aggressive towards women. And they don't tend to be collaborative in their approach to handling things. And finally, let's talk about family responsibilities. A woman, most of the time, is a wife. She's a mother. She takes care of the elderly ones also in the family. And this responsibility can be quite overwhelming for women. Yet, we believe that these are traditional gender roles, you know, because of what our culture and our practices are. And these things, they tend to affect the career trajectory of a lot of our women out there. All of these and many more are some of the issues that women face in aspiring to leadership positions. Now, how can we men improve visibility? Let's begin to focus on solutions. How can we help women to increase their visibility out there so that they can be seen, so that they can be heard, so that they can be given that space, even in positions of authority? Number one, we need to begin to challenge the stereotypes and the bias. We need to start addressing these stereotypes. We need to have a lot of advocacy on diversity and inclusion. And we must educate people about these biases and these stereotypes, the fact that they are harmful and they are not doing us any good. They are denying us the opportunity of harvesting those skills and competence that women can bring to bear in helping our organizations to get better. Both men and women, we must challenge these biases. We must challenge these stereotypes. Secondly, women, you need to support other women. It's quite interesting that women don't even support themselves. The last election, there were a lot of women on the ballot boxes, both for the National Assembly elections, the governorship elections across various states, even at the presidential level. Meanwhile, we found out that the population of women that votes or are qualified to vote, the market women, you know, that you see out there that go out to campaign for candidates and all of that, most of the rallies, you see a lot of the women, they are the ones dancing and singing and all of that. But when it's time to vote, they don't support other women. It is time for women to become cheerleaders for other women in leadership positions at work. Provide that environment that is supporting for other women, because you need to sing your own songs. Nobody wins in the dark. You need to sing your own songs. You need to begin to support yourselves. When women support each other, incredible things happen. Incredible things happen because you have that power of collaboration and cooperation. This is very, very apt. Women must learn to take initiatives. Don't wait to be handed over the opportunity. Seek it, find it out, and prepare for it. Nobody serves leadership position a la carte. Power is not served a la carte. You must be determined. You must go for it. Volunteer for challenging assignments. Be proactive with problem solving in your space. What can you do? Don't seek leadership position just because you are a woman. Own the skill. Prepare yourself. Have the competence. Grow. Have a growth mindset so that when the opportunities come, you seek it and you go for it because you are capable, not because you are a woman, but because you are capable to compete in that space and to deliver. The words of former number one professional tennis player, Chris Evert, she said that you've got to take the initiative and play your own game because in a decisive set, confidence is the difference. So women, you need to have confidence in yourself, have confidence in your ability. But for you to have that confidence, you must acquire the skills, the competence, and the capability because you cannot give what you don't have. Beauty is good. Good structure, body shape, and size is nice, fantastic. However, the beauty without brain is nothing. It can't get you there. You need the capacity and the capability. To make that difference, you must build the confidence. And to build the confidence, you must have the competence. This is very, very critical. How can women be visible? You have to be resilient. Get out of your comfort zone. You must be able to get out of your comfort zone to be able to contribute at work. Don't just sit and be comfortable in your little space. What makes a good CFO? What makes a good CEO? What are the qualities, the characteristics, the attributes, the competencies that is required to be the chief human resource officer, the chief people officer in your organization? Seek those things out. Get out of your comfort zone and begin to make yourself visible. Make yourself visible. Maintain a positive mindset when you encounter negative challenges. Always be positive. Believe that nothing is impossible. Impossibility is in the mind. It is nothing. Because the resilient woman has learned through trial and error. She has gone through a lot of ups and downs, a lot of highs and lows, that she uniquely holds the power to create a life that satisfies her desires. And to demand satisfaction from others is to give away that power. You can find this quote in the 13 characteristics of resilient women. This is characteristic number 9, according to Pamela Alien. Women must be resilient. Toughen up. In this VUCA time, resilience is the key to staying visible and remaining visible. You need to be resilient. The mental capacity to be able to withstand the hard times and the tough times. Number 5 characteristic that I will need to talk about here for a woman to be visible is that you must know yourself and you must build up your confidence. Carry out an honest appraisal of your skills, your capabilities, your strengths, and your weaknesses so that you know what gaps to close. This is very, very important. Number 2, own your own accomplishments and your own faults. Don't point fingers. Don't blame the society. Don't blame the men. Don't blame situations. Don't blame nature. Don't blame nature. Take ownership. Learn from your mistakes and move on. Don't stay down. Learn from your mistake and move on. Practice assertiveness and positive self-talk. Promote yourselves. Wake up in the morning, look at the mirror, and say good things about yourself. Write down your proclamation and read it to yourself. Build your confidence level. It's very, very important. Now, I love to share this with us. 11 habits of confident woman. 1, she questions the status quo. She reserves the word yes for when she means it. She doesn't say yes when she means no. She uses positive words, words of affirmation and proclamation. She has very clear goals, set goals, very clear goals that are smart. She knows confidence is more than appearance. It's not just how you look. It's about what you know that gives you the boost. She displays confident body language and she knows her strengths. She creates her own success. She doesn't wait for somebody to create the success for her. She brings herself to the table. She focuses on positive and she leaves those negatives behind. She practices self-care and she steps out of her comfort zone. These are 11 habits of a confident woman. Know yourself and build your confidence. And seek mentorship and network strategically. Be very strategic about mentoring. This is HR mentoring. Be very, 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 very intentional about seeking mentorship. Look for women who have been able to go through all these difficulties and they've been able to get to the top. Have them around you in your network and be very strategic because your network determines your net worth. Be strategic about your network. Find professional mentors or role models that can provide support for you and guidance. Those that can hold your hand and help you to climb the ladder that they have already climbed. And please, when they help you to climb the ladder, don't remove that ladder when you get to the top. Remember that the others too need to climb that ladder and reach out to help them, to lift them up. Because some women also find themselves at the top and then they become the boss rather than being the mentor for other women. And that is a fear that a lot of women have about having female bosses. They believe that, yes, females are usually quite hostile to other females. But I believe that this is changing. And that's why I'm challenging you. Seek mentorship and network strategically. Learn from their professional journeys and their insights. It will always help. Quickly, as we move on and we begin to coast towards the end of my presentation so that we can have enough time for questions and answers. How can we inspire women inclusion in leadership? Number one, we must, as organizations and as HR people, let us help our organizations to create a very clear diversity and inclusion goals that can promote gender diversity in our workplace. We can work with leadership to have policies that gives quota that allows for women who have the competence, skills, capacity, and capability to occupy, you know, leadership positions. Even in projects, activities, let us include these women. Let's give them the opportunity. In projects, you know, small projects, big projects, let's begin to involve them. Let us have a clear policy on this. This includes creating more flexible workplace policies regarding childcare, parental leave, and harassment. We can look at our harassment policies. We can look at our childcare policies. We can look at our maternity leave policies and begin to tweak them. Let us create programs that will encourage inclusivity and diversity at work. This will help to encourage women participation. It's very, very important that we do this. Number two, we need to involve the men. Women, yes, we have the Beijing conference, we have the affirmative action, but all of this, if we don't find a way to include the men and involve them, we'll keep on struggling with all of this. Experience has shown that when a man is involved in this process, they own that narrative and they become the advocates. Like myself now, I've become an advocate for women inclusion, always trying to look out for them. Because I've had the opportunity of working with female bosses, even in several aspects of my life, both, you know, career and even in my professional, you know, association. I've been mentored by a lot of women. And I find it very interesting how they're able to juggle the home front and, of course, their career and even their professional life. And it's been a wonderful experience till date. Again, we can promote awareness and we can challenge those harmful behavior and attitude, you know, that actively encouraging the men to champion women participation. These are things that we can do to inspire the women, you know, to be involved and be included at the top. Other things that we need to look at is women, like I said earlier on, let us celebrate ourselves. Let's celebrate the women leaders that we have amongst us. And let's reach out to them to coach and to mentor other ones. Let us be deliberate about mentorship and coaching in our organization. Let's have a policy around this. We can assign coaches, even to females within the organization, to help them to develop, you know, different leadership styles. and let us close the pay gap. HR people, company men experts, let us advise our organization appropriately. There cannot be discriminatory, you know, pay policies across gender and across race or culture. This will ensure that women are also paid fairly for their contributions, you know, to work. Okay, women, you need to believe in yourself, because charity begins at home. You must cultivate very strong sense of self-belief. Recognize your skills, your talents, your potential. Believe in your ability to lead effectively. Don't be couched by your environment. Step out. Seek role models. Seek role models who can help you. And then you need to learn from their experiences and the strategies that has helped them to climb the ladder. And as we said earlier on, network is very good, and create an environment that is supportive, you know, in our workplaces. And more importantly, women, when you find yourself in a position of authority, lead by example. Don't be that woman that has been given the opportunity but decides to abuse it. Lead by example. When a woman is successful in leadership role, it encourages even everybody. Support other women and give them the opportunity to be able to take on those roles, especially when they have the capacity and the competence to be able to lead effectively. As we climb, as we coast to the end, let's engage in the chat room. I will be giving us pictures of some prominent Nigerian women. If you know their names, just put it in the chat room as we begin to engage. I will be putting some pictures. If you know the name, just put the name of the person in the chat room. This person, how many of us know her? What is her name? Who is she? How can we describe her? Let's engage in the chat room. Who is this woman on the screen? How can we describe her? What is she known for? Damilola, yes, I've seen that. What is she known for? Yes, that's her name, correct. She's an educationist, yes. She's an educationist. Apart from being an educationist, what else do we know her for? What else do we know her for? I'm waiting. Let's see. An activist. Yes, she's an activist. Yes. She's an activist. Yes. Dogged, resolute, firm, and a strong believer in fairness and equity. She's an advocate for women in government. Yes. She's a former minister. Yes. She speaks up for the girl child. Yes. Influence in political sphere. Yes. She is transparent, accountable. Yes. Former minister, Madam Due Diligence. Exactly. Madam Due Diligence. Okay. So, yes, she's famous for Bring Back Our Girls campaign. She is an economic policy expert. Yes, she's a former minister of education and mineral resources. More importantly, she's a wife, and she's a mother of three. Exactly. She's a mother, a wife, and a role model. Yes. Let's clap our hands for Dr. Mrs. Obi Ezekwesili. Yes, you can use your icon. Let's clap for her. This is one of the women who, against all the odds, they've been able to break the glass ceiling. Yes. She's been able to break the glass ceiling, and she's able to show that a woman can successfully hold leadership positions. Let's look at another person. Let's look at another person. Who knows her? Who knows her? Who knows the second person in glasses? Who is she? Yes, Presh. Yes, her full name. What do we know her for? What do we know her for? Yes. No, this is not for Lorisha Lakija. No, this is Mrs. Ebukun Awoshika. Yes, Nene, she's your favorite. Good, fantastic. She has remained consistent. Yes. Consistency, Dr. Mrs. Ebuka Awoshika. She's your role model, Wofai Obonga. Great. A successful banker? No, she was not a banker. Mm-mm. She wasn't a banker, but there's something that links her to a banker. Yes, a former chairman of First Bank, the first female board chairperson of a commercial institution. Yes, she's a pastor, a wife, a mother, and a businesswoman. Thank you very much, Chike Lomo. Yes, She's the first female chairman of any financial institution in Nigeria. That is CEO also for, Charles Center, a public speaker. She's an entrepreneur. She's a philanthropist. And more importantly, she's also a wife and a mother. She's able to juggle all of this whole thing together. Yet, she remains successful in all of it. Okay, let's look at another woman there. Who knows her? Let's see. Who knows this lady here? This next lady. Who is she? Who is she? Let's see how much of our wonderful women in Nigeria that we know. Chimamanda Adichie. Chimamanda Adichie. Yes. The famous Chimamanda. Yes. Odelua won. That is her chieftaincy title. She is a young woman. Yes, she's young. Yes. Yes, I agree she's young. What else do we know about her? What else do we know about Chimamanda? Yes, she's young. What else do we know about? She's a writer. Yes, she's a writer. She's an amazing writer. Yes, Jessica, yes. Apart from that, she's an author. She's a novelist. Yeah, a prolific writer. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Kelo Mofala, Share, Theophilus, Gloria. Thank you very much. Yes. She is an advocate for feminism and women inclusion. Recently, she received a chieftaincy title of Odelua. She is also a wife and she is a mother. She's able to juggle all of this ball. You see what I talk about being task focused? She's able to juggle all of this ball. And despite all of that, she remains a successful woman. Okay, let's see a bit more, even as we begin to round up. Yes, who is she? Who is she on the screen? Who is this wonderful woman on the screen? Who is this wonderful woman on our screen? Yes, Kikelo Mofala Share. Yes, thank you very much. She is Mrs. Pastor Mrs. Folorunsho Alakija. Pastor Mrs. Folorunsho Alakija. What do we know her for? What do we know her for? What do we know Dr. Mrs. Folorunsho? Yes, she is an oil mogul, the chairman of Farm Oil. Correct. Thank you, Adiola Falodun. Yes, please. So she is a billionaire, the founder of Rose of Sharon Group, and of course, Farm Oil. And she's the president of Fadan, and she was a former managing director of First City Monuments Bank. She's also a wife. And she is a mother. Yes, this is Dr. Mrs. Ola Brown, an advocate for better health access. She's also an author and a public speaker. The next person on our screen, somebody has mentioned her earlier on, Mo Abudu. Mo Abudu, the famous Mo Abudu. She's a broadcaster, an entrepreneur, a movie producer. As we round up, now, who remembers this lady on our screen now? We've looked at those in business. Let's look at those in other areas of life. Other women who are demonstrating physical attributes. Yes, Fresh, this, yes, you are correct. Toby Amusho, the popular Toby Amusho. She, against all the odds, she went out there to become one of the queens, you know, that we have in the track and field events. She's a world record holder in the 100 meters hurdle. The next person that we have here, who remembers her? In the space where our men have not been able to conquer and have so many trophies. Agbabola, yes, Damilola, this is Agbabola. That is her nickname. That is her nickname. Asisat Oshoala, popularly called Agbabola. She's one of the Forbes 30 under 30 in 2021, winning the African UEFA Champions League in 2021 and the first African woman to score a goal in the UEFA Champions League. And finally, who can remember this lady on our screen? Who can remember this lady on our screen? Yes. Who can remember the lady on our screen? Who remembers this lady on our screen? Ha, this chat room is quiet now. This face does not look familiar. Let me give us
Jazzy.
Your
phone.
She's a Nigerian. Yes, former UN Secretary, Dr. Amina Bala Mohammed. Yes, Amina J. Mohammed, Deputy UN Secretary General, an advocate for gender equity, a former Minister of Environment, and of course, she is a mother and also a wife. Thank you very much, everyone. Even as I round up so that we can have some time for question and answer, I have a poem for all our women on this call. I have a poem for all our women on this call. In the dance of life, they lead with grace, women, the stars of this cosmic race. With hearts that swear and the spirit bold, they paint the world in hues of gold. In every tale, they write their mark with wisdom's quill and courage stark. Through trials faced and battles won, their resilience shines like the morning sun. From mother's love to sister's embrace, they weave connections, creating space. In every role, they play their part. With love and kindness, they fill the heart. With voices strong, they break the chains of inequality and unjust claims. They stand united, hand in hand, together, forging a brighter land. So here is the women, fierce and free, with boundless strength and empathy. In their lights, we find our way, celebrating them every single day. Please, let's stand together for all the women in our lives and all the women that are blazing the trail and conquering new grounds. Thank you very much for listening to me. Thank you very much for listening to me. Over to you, Yemi Adeyemi.
Thank you so much, elected council member. Adeyemi Ajayi, that was phenomenal. That was befitting. That is what we say when you want to celebrate women. You bring the best and you deliver the best. That was spot on. Ladies and gentlemen, if you have a question and if you have a comment, a contribution, a testimony, a goodwill message, anything in support of women or your personal story, please, if you raise your hands, we'll unmute you and give you the floor. Also, if you prefer to send a chat message, but tonight I feel like hearing voices, really and truly.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes. So just raise your hands.
Women.
Yes, let's hear your voice. Yes, Madam Adeola Adepegba, you have the floor. Then we'll take Victoria Uba Azaria. Madam Adeola first. Please keep your hands
yeah,
on.
You're
welcome.
All right. Yeah, thank you very much. Our own ECM Adeyemi, thank you very much. It was spot on. Our time was spent. Gained a lot. Thank you. God bless you for that presentation, sir. So I just want to share my experience. When you were talking, you asked us to, you know, vote. Who do we want as a boss? And a lot of us actually voted men. And sincerely speaking, that is what is happening in the space of work. I will not lie to you. If I want a line manager today, I want a man to supervise me. Because women are seen as tigress. We want that thing to happen immediately, you know? So we cease to run away from women leader. And prefer men. I would also like to say that one of the reasons why some women don't support other women is I use my office as an for example. In a place of work, but in most offices, if you do a research or if you carry out a research, how between men and women who take holiday or who goes off work mostly, you will find out that it's women. They will come and tell you, my child is sick, They will come and tell you, I want to go to school to pay school fee. They will come and tell you, I have a PTA meeting. They will come and tell you.
Seems our network is not.
I'm not saying all the ladies, though. I'm just taking a few examples. Do you understand? You give them work. If you give, if you take a research, or if you give three men work, three women work, before one woman will deliver, two men would have delivered, and they would have delivered work before a lady or a woman will deliver. And so many times, you know, ladies, I also want to speak to us. We need to sit back. We need to think.
The network is unstable. I don't know the gender of the network.
No, the gender of the network is male.
It's male, okay.
It's male. I tell you, that would be a male gender.
Okay. I think we quickly, hopefully she'll come back. Let's take Blessing, Oluwa Lucy. Then we take Ochi. Blessing, please. Okay, Victoria, your hands are back up. You can speak, Victoria, since your hands were originally up. Just unmute and speak. I've made you a co-host. You can unmute, Victoria.
Good evening, sir. Can you hear me, please?
Yes, we can. Go on.
Yes,
okay,
ma'am.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for the privilege to speak. It's quite unfortunate. I didn't remember the time, so I joined at the tail end of this program, and I appreciate the poem I saw. And to be frank, I had to screenshot it because I just fell in love with it. Thank you so much, sir. I want to use this medium to appreciate the one person in my life that made it possible for me to stand up to this HRO profession, and Wofi of Meridian Hospital, the HRM. I want to appreciate her because through her, I've got to learn a lot. I've got to learn about inclusion, about women in the workspace, because she's a great mentor to me. And through her, I've met Sao Luofemi. Yeah, so I appreciate her so much. I want to urge women, just like the last speaker was saying, that if you give women, two women jobs and three men jobs, the men will deliver faster. The experiment is so much because as women, we have a lot, but we will try as much as possible to stand up to the task, because it's not just the men gender that has to be out there. It's high time women, we stand up to the expectation, we stand up to include ourselves in the workspace. Just as she said, most of us prefer the male gender to be our boss. I've experienced that too. If a male is leading me, he tends to have that listening ear. He tends to understand, oh, why is this man speaking this way? Why is she? But if it's a female, I don't know, sometimes we have these clashes. Sorry to say, but that's the truth. We have this clash because person, maybe she's an emotional type, it wants to play into what you're trying to explain, and some of them don't tend to listen to really understand the aspect you're coming from. So I urge women, we need to understand our emotions. We need to understand where this person is coming from. We need to open our ears to listen very well and understand, because the men gender tends to listen better and try to fit in. But the female, God will help us. So that's my own contribution from this end. Thank you so much, sir. I appreciate it.
Thank you so much. Let's take Coach Chi. Coach Chi, you have the floor, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you for this beautiful presentation. My amiable mentor, fellow Adeyemi Ajayi, it's always a beautiful time to be under your learning. Okay, so I want to just buttress on what the first speaker said about, lady that talked about her women in the workplace. I also voted a man. And this is because I had to, when you told us to vote, I had to just go down memory lane and I started counting how many male bosses have I had. In the whole of my 15 years of career, I've only had one female. And I'll say that she was not instrumental in my career growth. I can't even remember what I learned from her. You know, so, but everything I've learned to the glory of God has been, have been rather under men's tutelage. So I feel like there is this stereotype about women by women. We usually feel, okay, like this year's theme for the Women's Day is inspire inclusion. I'll say that it's even women that should inspire inclusion amongst ourselves and not even men. We always feel like we're talking to men. Oh, men are not giving us the venue to get our voice heard. But the truth is, we are the ones that usually stand as the roadblock to our fellow women. And I've told myself that I'll remain intentional to change the narrative. So I just hope that women will do better at the workplace. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Thank you for that intervention. Let's have Alhaji Ahmed Gobil. You have the floor, sir.
Thank you very much, Yemi Adeosun. And then let me also say thank you very much, Adeyemi Ajayi, for this very wonderful delivery. When you ask us to vote for who we will prefer for a boss, I chose a female boss. And I would like to just quickly just share my story. Unfortunately, or fortunately for me, my experience has been the other way around from what I've heard our women speak about here. In all of my life, and when I say all of my work life, I have worked for about 35, a little over 35 years now, and I'm still working. And in all my life, my work life, I have had only one female boss, who is my current boss. And I make bold to say here today that the 2.5 years I have spent working with this woman has been the best of my 37 years career. And I'm saying this because the lady I currently work with is younger. But you know, when you say a woman is a mother hen, my boss today is a mother hen. You know, one who has got your back at all times, one who puts your family first before anything. I am a grandfather. All I need, for example, at work, if I dare mention that one of my grandchildren, you know, is not feeling too well, Gloria will say, Alhaji, if you need to go and be with your wife and your granddaughter or grandson, please go ahead. Just take with you your laptop and make sure your phone is close by with you. If I need you urgently for anything, I will give you a call or I'll send you a message on things. The boss I had before her was a man, someone I had known since our university days, way back in the 80s. But here was a boss who, for example, and I want to give this example. Immediately after COVID, we all started, of course, during COVID, we all started working with Microsoft, Teams. And in my place of work, we will start meeting at 8:30 in the morning. You know, in fact, 8 o'clock in the morning at the time. I live somewhere around Lekki. Of course, my house was just 15 minutes away from the office. I have a driver. But per adventure, my driver comes late and I decide to drive to the office. This boss expects me to join the meeting at 8 o'clock. And when we start the meeting, he calls on me, Ahmed Gubir, can we have you have your presentation? And I say, oh, boss, I'm actually driving. Can someone else please go ahead, you know, to this? You say, no. Ask any of our colleagues who is already in the office. Slide your presentation and you can go ahead and drive. For crying out loud, how do I start to make a presentation while driving? That is a man to a man, someone I had known for practically all of my work life. So tell me, if I were to choose between this man and this lady who I've only worked with for 2.5 years, you know, and several other men that I've worked with, I think women, and for those of us in HR, women bring compassion into HR. And I was speaking at a forum yesterday where we said, where policies, processes, and procedures end, that is where wisdom kicks in. I learned this from this woman whom I have worked with. She taught me that if you want to be a very good HR professional, you need to be empathetic. You also need to be compassionate. And you need to understand that for every person you work with, no matter how small their family may be, their family, you know, the well-being of their family should also count for you. If you want them, you know, to perform creditably at work, if you want them to pay attention to what they do. So I've had some very wonderful experience working with a lady for about 2.5 years now. And I've also had the privilege of working with Ibukun Awusika, whom we all mentioned here. Fantastic woman. So I agree that, yes, different strokes for different folks. But I do not think that we are doing some very good service, you know, to women if we think that, I think generally women are their greatest undoing themselves. Again, I've had the privilege of sitting on an interview somewhere outside Nigeria in one African country. And we were going to recruit somebody. We already had a salary for the position. And I'd have the woman HR manager saying, I had to pay this woman who want to recruit a salary much more lower than what the position was supposed to earn. And when I asked why, she said she has a husband who is taking care of her. You know, and that's why she should have a pay disparity for a role that we already have a salary benchmark for. So women, unfortunately, are their greatest undoing. Thank you very much for allowing me to make this intervention.
Wow. Isema De Emajai, do you want to react before we call on the next person to weigh in?
Okay. I was busy also reacting and responding in the chat room. You see, like someone said in the chat room, different strokes for different folks. However, the core of this is that for every one woman that you probably have a not too good experience with, there are over 9 other women who are fantastic in leadership roles. Up on December last year, I had 3 females reporting to me. And I tell you, it will have been better. Even in my absence, when you see the way they work, in fact, a lot of times I have to tell them, I don't want to see you ladies in the office on a Saturday or on a Sunday again. The extent to which they deliver and how passionate they are with their job. In fact, that's why when sometimes people say, women, when they do this, one of them got pregnant. Even when she was pregnant, she was much more productive during her pregnancy, even much more than when she wasn't pregnant. While she delivered, 3 weeks after her delivery, she started opening her laptop and started sending emails from home. I had to ask the IT team to shut that out of the system. I don't want her to touch anything. That is how much committed that she was. And she's a lady. So if you tell me that, if you give an assignment to a male and you give it to a female, This has nothing to do with the gender. It has to do with the person. Whether it's a man or a woman, if you have a bad attitude towards delivery, that it is you, your attitude, not because of the gender. Because there are quite a lot of women that are on this call. I know a woman on this call who rose through the ranks in the civil service in Lagos State to become a permanent secretary, even in an unusual ministry. She's on this call, juggling several balls together. And at time in that particular ministry, happens to be one of the best on record in Lagos State. I also know of another woman currently serving as a permanent secretary, but as a permanent secretary in the ministry in Lagos, quite a lot of them, both either in public sector or private sector. I can give you a lot of examples of women, even in your day-to-day lives, that are doing great things. My boss, who is now my sister, who taught me a lot of things that I do in HR. A lot of people see me on so many platforms, and you are wondering, the best person who has taught me and coached and mentored me on this journey is a woman. Shout out to Mrs. Adetoba. Up until today, even to my home, to my family, everything. So there are so many. So it is not about the gender most times. First is about the person, the human being, whether it's a male or a female. Unconscious bias, we need to be mindful of that unconscious bias. And like I projected earlier on again, women support women. Women support women. Let's continue with the chat.
Okay, so let's quickly go to Madam Obiageli Nwaeze. Obiageli, you have the floor.
Thank you, Mr. Oluyemi. Thank you, Mr. Adeyemi. It's been quite insightful listening to you, Mr. Adeyemi. Kudos for bringing us together this evening. So you literally took the words out of my mouth, because when I kept hearing people saying that women could be less productive and all that, in my head I was like, I've seen women that when they are ready to do something, they overdo it so interestingly that at the end of the day you'll be wondering, how come? I didn't think you could do it this well, so we do things and we do it exceptionally. That is for those that are willing to do certain things and take up certain tasks, so to say. But I would like to share my experience. I've had the opportunity to work in an organization or an industry where I realized that there was high level of gender discrimination there, And this obviously was not favorable to the women. I was the HRO manager for the organization. In fact, it was highly unionized. The setting there was a unionized setting. So most of the time, what I hear is that, Obiageli, see this recruitment, we need men, we need men, we need men. You know how the system is now, women cannot do this. Sometimes we do shift, we do that. So I kept on hearing a lot of excuses. In fact, when I got into that company, we had just maybe about 4 or 5. And then we had a workforce of over 120. So we had just about 4 or 5 women there. That's including myself. So I said, no. If I can come in, of course, I would come in and observe certain things. So when I came in from the get-go, I was like, okay, let me just give it a while. Maybe I don't want to jump into conclusion. Let me just, check out how things are being done here. Until it was clear to me that, no, it was highly, highly discriminatory towards the women. So I took it upon myself. I took upon myself that, no, I was going to try to change this. I seized the opportunity and then became actively involved, not like leaving it for HR officers, to handle recruitment and all that, And at the end of the day, what I kept telling people that was like my selling points was like, look at me, I'm doing it, right? Am I not doing it? I'm doing it. So if I can do it, I think we can give opportunities to other women out there to do the same. So at the end of the day, yeah, they were like, oh, okay, yes, you actually did XYZ. So before I left there, I was happy. It was a fulfillment for me that I was able to bring in quite a number of women into the system. So I want to encourage all women on this platform, to seize opportunities like this and support ourselves. All right. Thank you.
Wow. Thank you so much. Thank you so much, Obiageli, for that intervention. We would like to take Princess Adenike Adedoyin Ajayi. You have the floor, ma'am. She is the former Permanent Secretary, Ministry of Culture and Tourism, Lagos State. Thank you for joining us, ma'am. You have the floor, ma'am.
Good evening, everyone. Thank you so much, sir. And thank you, my fellow. Thank you for the shout out. Thank you to everyone for all of those very interesting contributions and the learnings that we're taking out of here today. I just wanted to, you know, talk a little bit more about why, you know, there's a rationale why some women are seen to not be encouraging, especially when they get to the top. And if you've worked in the civil service, you probably have an idea what I'm talking about. You know, they have this turn-by-turn mindset, and a lot of times it's the experience that they've had whilst trying to get out on their way to the top. And it's just, I can liken it to when you're in secondary school and, you know, your seniors were really bullying and really nasty, you know, whilst you were still a junior. And by the time you become a senior, you'll want to also take it out on all of the juniors that are coming behind you. And so the only way that we can start changing that narrative for those that get to the top as women and are not being nice to the others that are coming after them is to, you know, just be able to get yourself out of that mindset of, I didn't have it nice when I was coming here. I didn't have it nice to get to this place. So I'm not just going to give it to you that easy. You must work hard for it because it's really not necessary. And that's what, and that's why you see that majority of the people voted that they would have a man as a boss rather than a woman. And, you know, we really need to start looking at things in a way of what I call doing things right and doing the right thing. When you're doing things right, it's usually very in the books, what the record says, what the process says, because you're doing it by the books. But you cannot be an HR person, an HR practitioner, and go totally by the books. There are certain times when you are not going to do things right, you are going to do the right thing. The right thing, doing the right thing is what brings out the human being in you, so that you can also deal with you. And that's what my fellow Yemi was alluding to when she said, sometimes, you know, the women will understand. Although the record does not say that you can go and look at your child when your child is sick. I think Mr. Gobri also talked about it, that woman would say, if your grandchild is not all right, go. That thing is not in the book, so. It's not in their processes and procedures that whenever a staff's son or daughter or grandchild is sick, they should go. But because you are trying to do the right thing by being humane, by looking at things from the human angle. So if all of us can start doing that, start being humane in the way we are HR practitioners, in the way we are women in leadership roles, when we start being humane, you will not look at things from what you went through. You look at things at what needs to be done right, doing the right thing, not doing the right. I mean, doing things right, not, you understand what I'm saying? I'm getting myself confused out. You understand? So there's a difference between doing things right and doing the right thing. And so if we can all start doing the right thing is when you will slightly deviate from the processes and procedures, which is doing things right, into the human angle. That's why it's migrated from personnel management into human resource management, so that we can capture the essence of the human beings that are doing the work. Personnel are like robots. You know, there's no human face to them. But the minute you put that human to it, you start putting human faces and you start dealing with situations with a human touch in your heart and looking at things in a more, you know, humane way to dealing with all the people that you need to deal with. And women, when you start doing that, when you get to the top, you find out that you'll be more encompassing and embracing to the situations that comes to your table. Thank you very much for the opportunity to talk. God bless.
Wow, wow, wow. This is ancient wisdom. This is very deep. Maybe I will liaise with Ajayi. We'll give you a full day one time or a full session. At your convenience, any day, anytime, we'll walk around your shedruba. Thank you so much.
You're very welcome, man. You're very welcome, sir. I'm retired, not tired. Wow. You can ask my brother, my darling brother. Do you know what? I'm much older than him, but he's my mentor.
Wow. Wow.
And that's how to do about it. He's my mentor in a lot of ways. So thank you, my brother, for mentoring even your older sister. God bless you. Learning has no age barrier. If we can accept that, you can learn from anybody. You can learn from the top. You can learn from the bottom. You can learn vertically. You can learn horizontally. Just have an open growth mindset. That's what it is. Thank you, sir.
You are welcome. It's Emadi Emadia, you must say something.
Okay. Earlier on, I spoke about the need for women to have mentors and coaches. And like I said, I have a lot of women that I can really readily speak about, either in the public service or in the private sector, who have been able to go through a whole lot of all of these so-called unconscious biases, and they find themselves in leadership roles, and they've been able to perform and deliver across board. She talked about putting the human in the human resource and in the management. And that is key: empathy, compassion against policy and procedure. A lot of times, we don't necessarily have to set aside the policy or go against the policy. A lot of times, it's for us to even redraft the policy to be able to show that we are not dealing with equipment, but we are dealing with people who have emotions and, of course, who have a life. And that is what usually happens, even for a lot of women. Now, she mentioned about women who have passed through the very tough edge for them to actually get to the top. Again, for me, I say with absence of humility, it is not just about the gender. Can you all remember that university lecturer who said that nobody can pass his course or nobody can score an A? Nobody can have a first class in the department. Was he a woman? The truth of the matter is that most of these people who are ritually very, very hard and tough, they are not even the women. It's a man, oh yes, blessing. That man that said, oh, nobody has ever scored more than 60% in my score. That person that is harassing you sexually in school, that if you don't sleep with me, you are not going to pass my course. Was he a woman? So it is not about the gender. Okay, it is not about the gender. It is about the person. And that is the first place for a lot of ladies and women on this call to start from. If you know what skill, what competency, what capacity you need to develop for you to be able to get to the top, if you are able to demonstrate all of those competencies, you will be sought out and you'll be sought after. You won't even be looking for the opportunity or pleading for it. They will come and look for you. I have a CFO in my office. My CFO, by the way, shout out to Oyinda Akombi. She's one of the youngest CFOs that you have in a multinational company in Nigeria. She became a CFO within an 8 years career, working through different multinational companies. I tell you, when she starts to speak, you know, on the management scene, even when everybody, when we have both spoken, we'll listen to her. In fact, we'll say no, we are not deciding until when she has spoken. I have another, she is below 40 years old, for you to even have an idea. Then I have another woman on my management team, Jasna. Jasna is a Croatian. She's 62 years of age. I tell you, when it comes to clinical practice in my own sector, she's one of the best globally. And she didn't, we had to go and look for her all the way from Nigeria, South Africa to Croatia to bring her on board. And she's a woman. She's a grandmother. I tell you, a lot of my medical doctors and all of that here, they struggle when she's talking about clinical practice and clinical governance matters. So if you have the skill, you have the knowledge and the right attitude and the competency, you will get to the top. You will be sought after. So let us set aside this bias. Let us set aside the stereotype. Women support women. That is the strength of a woman.
Thank you so much. We'll take the final feedback from Kike Lomo Falashe. Then we'll take a question on the chat box and closing remarks from our esteemed facilitator. Madam Kike Lomo Falashe, you have the floor. Sorry for keeping you waiting.
No, it's fine. I've been learning from everything everybody has been saying. Thank you so much, Mr. Adeyemi. It's been an enlightening session. I would just reiterate what you said earlier about it not being gender leadership. It's not about whether he's a man or a woman. In my short year of working, I've had the privilege of having 2 male bosses, 2 female bosses, and the female came first. My first work experience was a female boss, and I tell you, I swore in my life that any line manager that they give you that is a woman, I will run away. She made it so difficult. But fortunately for me, the next boss I had was the woman. Oh my God. She's the best thing that happened to me. She changed my orientation about what a female boss should be. And then I had 2 male bosses after that. The male boss, the first one was, was a lot. I was like, ah. And then now I have a male boss that is also a mentor to me. And he's literally leading me by the hand and teaching me all that there is to know. So I would want us to be careful of the unconscious bias that men are this or women are this. No, it's the person. It's the person. It's not about whether it's a man or a woman. So I want us to, like you have said, women, we also need to do more for ourselves. We're having a webinar in my office yesterday, and the discussion was about women supporting women. Even when men want to include us in all of this, we see women ourselves being the ones to say, ah, she's a woman, no, she cannot. So I think we also really, really need to do better. But the most important thing, this unconscious bias, leadership is not really the gender. It's who is holding that office that makes it what it is. Thank you.
Jill, thank you so much. Thank you so much. So let's quickly go to the questions here. From Blessing Oluwa Lucy, 2 questions, and I'll take them. They are a fallout of some of your suggestions and recommendations. The first question here, Blessing says, for mentorship, what are the steps or procedure needed to get a mentor in one's journey of life? Let me quickly add the second question so you take them in one breath. Question 2, Blessing says here, what are the measures that can be put in place for everyone to be included? Because I understand that this inclusion is for everyone.
All right, thank you. So talking about the steps towards getting a mentor, number one is, what exactly is the area that you want to be mentored on? Is it a technical skill? Is it a soft skill? So once you have identified that area of mentorship that you need, then identify the person who has done that thing successfully and is still probably doing that thing that people can reckon with. 3, validate your assertion. That is, confirm from other people that that person that you have identified that has done that particular thing successfully, that truly your assertion is correct. Then once you have done that, the next step is to find out how you can reach out to that person. Who knows that person? Do you have direct access to that person? Or do you know somebody who knows that person who you can walk through to get to that person? Oftentimes, if you don't know the person, you can reach out on LinkedIn via email, via SMS, via WhatsApp, introduce yourself, and then create the basis for the person to understand why you would love the person to mentor you. Don't forget, a mentorship relationship is a trust relationship. So you need to first be able to build some level of trust for the person to be able to understand, okay, fine, whether the person will be open to mentoring you or not. Usually, people who are very good at mentoring, they will call for a first meeting to first clarify exactly what your objective really is. And when they have clarified your objective and they've agreed that, yes, you are very clear about what you want to achieve, they will then set parameters for the mentorship. You then go into how you will meet, when you will meet, the frequency of your meeting, the time, duration of your meeting, and how you are going to monitor your progress. And if there's going to be a time frame for the mentorship, or it's going to be a lifetime mentorship relationship. So these are the steps that you ordinarily would take. In another climb also, for organizations can also be intentional about mentorship program. In such a situation, the organization can be deliberate about identifying leaders who have made themselves available and are willing and ready to mentor others. And then the organization can then, HR, working with other line managers and, you know, a project team, they can then carefully assign mentors to mentees within the organization. And they will create a frame, they will have developed a framework. That's very important. They develop a framework for the mentoring relationship. And then they will work within that framework to assign mentees to mentors. They will create the monitoring and feedback mechanism to be able to review what is going on, and then look at the outcomes and the results, and then they will tweak it as time goes on. So whether it's a formal mentoring arrangement within the organization, or if it is going to be a personal mentoring situation, those of the two scenarios can play out. Now, the second question, talking about, remind me again. The second question was talking
around the inclusion.
Inclusion for everyone. Now, there is a law about diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging in Nigeria. So when we talk about diversity, equity, inclusion, and belonging, it is wider than just gender. It's not just gender-based. But because we are only focusing on gender because of the celebration that we are having right now, in terms of that, now, I am not an advocate of deliberately just creating a space or a quota system for one gender or the other to fill. I'm not really so much of an advocate for that. I am more of a performance-driven, capacity-driven person. So I will approach this from the point of view of creating a developing capacity and a learning environment where you can identify people with skills, okay? And then you can be deliberate about it, whether male or female, because sometimes we can focus so much on including women to the extent that we forget the men, and then we create another problem again on its own. I've seen that happen in some organization where at the end of the day, you have about 90% of the leadership as women, and the men just feel completely neglected out of the situation. It often happens, you know, because there's so much focus, there's so much noise, and about then you now become so deliberate and intentional that you forget the fact that then the men now start to protest also. So we must try to strike a delicate balance, create an atmosphere that is fair and that's equity for everybody to be able to thrive, irrespective of your gender, your race, your physical look. If you create that kind of environment that's given for equity and fairness, even the female who have seen that the atmosphere, the policy, the situation, circumstances, the ecosystem is fair, they will aspire for the roles and they'll be more determined and more daring. That is my own approach to inclusion, beyond just creating a space for women. Because most of the time, when we just create the space, most times we tend more towards tokenism. We just want to tick the box that, oh, we have 50% female, 50% male. But when we get to the table for us to take decisions, when the women are talking, we tell them to go and sit down. You are only here because you just wanted to fill a quota. Go and sit down. What are you saying? What are you talking? Because in the first instance, we didn't select her because of her competence, because she's a human being, because she's ably qualified to sit on that particular table. We picked her because we just wanted to fill a quota. So that's why we have to create an environment that promotes equity, fairness, and give equal opportunity to all gender. While we then begin to look at equity, treat the female gender, understanding their specific and peculiar circumstances, such that the policies support those circumstances. The same thing with the male gender. So that we don't forget that while we're having 16 weeks and more maternity leaves for women to take care of, you know, them, we should not forget that we also need to have paternity leave for the men so that they can be available to also mentor our children and be there also for their family. So that is what I call inclusion and diversity. Don't give women 16 months, don't increase 12 weeks leave to 16 weeks leave without remembering to also have at least a 7 days or a 2 weeks for the men also to be able to support in the home. So that is, for me, that is diversity and inclusion. Don't give a woman the opportunity of a parental care or a child care leave. And you say that a man cannot also take a child care leave to be able to support his wife to take care of a child that have a need. That is inclusion and diversity for me. So our policies must not be gender specific, but it must be gender friendly across all gender. So those will be my answers to those two questions. We can engage more even outside this platform. Thank you.
Thank you so much. I have a small contribution in 1 minute. Thank you to everyone that joined tonight and everyone who will watch the session on YouTube. I'd just like to say, beyond the focus on the workplace, please, for our children, for our daughters, let us encourage them. The equity starts from when they are children. Your daughters will not want to learn taekwondo or football, and you will say, no, it is for boys. Your son should not want to enter the kitchen to cook or do something domestic, and you say, no, it is for the sisters. All the children, boys, girls, give them equal opportunity. Don't prejudice their mind against any profession or any. So your daughter, it's okay for your daughter to wash a car, and it's okay for your son to make the eba. Because sometimes when we speak about stereotypes, it is ingrained in us because we were fed this stereotype from childhood. So it is very important that what we have to unlearn through struggle now, we should make it easy for our children not to even go through those kind of stereotypes and discrimination. I'd like to say it has been a privilege, an honor, having with us fellow Adeyemi Ajayi, elected council member on this platform tonight. Sir, by popular demand, you will be back. God willing, we will work around your timing and availability and any topic of your choice. Also like to celebrate every woman and then all the men who love them that joined this special edition tonight for staying through 2 hours of instructive information, education around helping women navigate and become elevated and advanced in their workplace. We do not take this for granted. Ladies and gentlemen, we call it a wrap. See you another time. Good night, everyone.
Good night.
Good night, everyone. Thank you.